And let us read. Therefore, when he was gone out, Jesus said, Now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God be glorified in him, God shall also glorify him in himself, and shall straightway glorify him. Little children, yet a little while I am with you. Ye shall seek me, and as I said unto the Jews, whither I go, ye cannot come. So now I say to you, a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have loved one to another. Simon Peter said unto him, Lord, whither goest thou? Jesus answered him, Whither I go, thou canst not follow me now, but thou shalt follow me afterwards. Peter said unto him, Lord, why cannot I follow thee now? I will lay down my life for thy sake. Jesus answered him, Wilt thou lay down thy life for my sake? Verily, verily, I say unto thee, the cock shall not crow till thou hast denied me thrice. John 14:1-3. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, ye may be also. Shall we bow our heads to pray? O Holy Father, I need you now. Speak to my heart, Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name I pray, and I thank you for hearing me. Amen. I've entitled this little talk, Is Love Enough? In John 14:1, it reads, Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. Let's stop a moment and ask ourselves, why would our hearts be troubled if we really believe in God, if indeed we really knew him? Why are some of us so downcast, especially on Sabbath? Yes, I know the Bible says that we shall suffer persecution for his sake, but did you also read where it says, rejoice in persecution and trials and tribulations? When we allow the enemy to cast dark clouds of doubt and discouragement upon us, God is dishonored. Do you trust him? Again, do you really know him? Looking at verse 2 of John 14, it reads, In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. Let's stop again and ask ourselves, do you really believe that Jesus is in heaven preparing a place for you and me? Do you really believe this? And not only that, he said he was preparing mansions. How many of you are now living in mansions? Why are we so content, settled for less when we are children of the King? The Lord is disappointed when his people place a low estimate upon themselves. He desires his chosen heritage to value themselves according to the price he has placed upon them. They may expect large things if they have faith in his promises. Some of us are now enjoying the so-called riches of this world. But do you know Jesus? Are your things enough to satisfy the heart longings? Do you feel the sweet peace of Jesus? Can you say within yourself with all sincerity that all is well with your soul? Don't misunderstand me. God wants his children to have the very best of everything, to do the best in whatever they do. But he doesn't want the things to cloud our view of him. When we know God, as it is our privilege to know him, our life will be a life of continual obedience. Please note that all true obedience comes from the heart. Now going back to verse 3, it reads, And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, ye may be also. When Jesus told his disciples that he was to go away, the dark clouds again appeared, for they were very dependent upon Jesus. They pressed closer to him as if by doing so, he would not leave. I'd like to ask you a question this morning. Who are you dependent on? Who or what are you clinging to besides Jesus? Is it your parents, friends, jobs? What thing is keeping you from serving Jesus with your whole heart? Our brother Peter, one of Jesus' most loved disciples, always quick to speak, asked Jesus, "Lord, where are you going?" Jesus answered him, "Wherever I go, you cannot follow me now, but you shall follow me afterwards." Peter said unto him, "Lord, how come I can't follow you now? I will lay down my life for thy sake." Jesus answered him, "Will thou lay down thy life for my sake? Verily, verily, I say unto thee, the cock shall not crow till thou hast denied me thrice." How many lies have you told Jesus lately? How many times did the cock have to crow before you would deny that you know him? When Peter made these statements that he will follow his Lord to prison and death, he meant it, every word of it. But Peter did not know himself. The Savior saw in him a self-love assurance that would overbear even his love for Christ. Christ's solemn warning was a call to heart searching. Peter needed to distrust himself and to have a deeper faith in Christ. It is time for us all to do a little heart searching. Who is your trust in? Is it Pastor Brown? The heads of the many church departments? Have you fallen on the rock? Are you broken? When Jesus left, he sent the Spirit of truth, the Comforter, the Holy Spirit. His work is to define and maintain the truth. He first dwells in the heart as the Spirit of truth, and thus become the Comforter. There is comfort and peace in the truth. Through the Scriptures, the Holy Spirit speaks to the mind and impresses truth upon the heart. It is by the Spirit of truth, working through the Word of God, that Christ subdues his chosen people to himself. The Holy Spirit was the highest of all gifts that Jesus could solicit from his Father for the exaltation of his people. Christ was given his Spirit as a divine power to overcome all hereditary and cultivated tendencies to evil and to impress his character upon his church. A profession of religion places men in the church, but the character and conduct show whether they are in connection with Christ. If they bear no fruit, they are false branches. In his last meeting with his disciples, the great desire which Christ expressed for them was that they might love one another as he had loved them. Again and again, he spoke this. The command to love one another had a new meaning in the light of his self-sacrifice. The whole work of grace is one of continual service of love, of self-denying, self-sacrificing effort. During every hour of Christ's sojourn upon earth, the love of God was flowing from him in irrepressible strength. All who are imbued with his Spirit will love as he loved. So, my Christian friends, I invite you to look around. Is there someone seated here today who you feel you can't love, and you said in your heart, "I don't care what God or anyone else says, I can't stand the man or woman"? Jesus said, this love is evidence of their discipleship with him. "By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have loved one to another." I invite you today to pray for the gift of genuine love, which only comes from Christ. Before Jesus left, he also had words of comfort for his little children. He told that peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you.